Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Sanofi Genzyme Company for their invitation to talk about Pompe disease. And also, we would like to thank the organizing committee of the Eminence at United Arab Emirates. Our talk today will focus more on the late onset Pompe disease. We'll start about the genetic testing, about the genetic and the inheritance. Pompe disease is inherited as autosomal recessive. Both parents must be carriers of the Pompe disease. 25% chance of each birth in that case, the child will have Pompe disease. The overall incidence is around 1 in 40,000. Worldwide prevalence is 1 in 57,000. GA gene located on chromosome 17q25. More than 300 mutation on GAA gene identified to date. Pompe is inherited autosomal recessive disease. As you see on the right side, both parents are carriers, and in that case, 50% of the children will be carrier, and 25% chance that the child will have the disease. So it is an acid alpha glucosidase encoded by the single GAA gene. Each person inherits two alleles. So pathogenic GAA variant lead to varying amount of function, around 500 GAA variant, which may alter the following: either RNA splicing, protein synthesis, GAA enzyme activities, and GAA processing transport to the lysosomes. That will give genotype-phenotype correlation. Individual with Pompe disease have two pathogenic GAA variants usually. Patient inherit different combination, which lead to various levels of functional GAA enzyme activities, which lead ultimately to variable onset and presentation. The pathophysiology of the disease. Pathologically, GAA variant lead to the deficiency of lysosomal GAA, which ultimately impaired the glycogen breaking down. Glycogen accumulate in the lysosome throughout the body, which ultimately lead to muscle weakness and damage, which affect the cardiac muscles, skeletal muscle, including even the respiratory and smooth muscles. And it is ultimately is a multisystemic involvement. Glycogen accumulation lead to progressive, irreversible muscle damage, which is ultimately, first of all, start by lysosomal accumulation, as you see on the left top slide here, with fatty glycogen filled lysosomal. And at this stage, still the patient, if started enzyme replacement therapy early, will be, if there is any small damage, it can be reversible at that point. And the patient is usually asymptomatic at this stage. Then expanding lysosomes, which lead to started dysfunctional muscles, and the patient will start have mild to moderate muscles or symptoms, or especially muscle weakness. Ruptured lysosomes will lead to significant damage on the muscle, as you see from the histopathology here, with severe muscle disease and febrile dysregulation. The cytoplasmic, it is not only lysosomal, ultimately cytoplasmic glycogen storage, which lead to necrosis and severe muscle damage, and extensive damage to the muscle and impaired function. And at this stage, actually, the damage is usually irreversible. But at least with starting the treatment, it might hold on the progression of the disease. So what are the clinical characteristics of this disease? So differentiating of Pompe disease from other myopathies, it's associated with elevated serum CK. Usually around 70% of the cases will have high CK. Elevated urine hexose 4 fraction, which indicate glycogen accumulation. Also decrease in upright or supine forced vital capacity, which reduce its secondary or a marker of reduced muscle strength, and could be an early sign in patient with Pompe. Fatty replacement in the trunk or the thigh muscles, it is visible by the MRI. These feature increase suspicion of Pompe disease, but their absence also does not rule Pompe. The patient may vary in general term to describe their symptoms. Sometimes they will describe their muscle weakness as weak or tired or feeling fatigue or pain. However, it is important to recognize such recognize them as muscle and respiratory issues. So the clinical characteristics of this patient, this is, as we said, the Pompe disease is a multisystemic disease and going to affect many systems in the body, like skeletal muscles, respiratory, central nervous system, like cognitive or stroke-like, and cognitive impairment, peripheral and autonomic nervous system, vascular system also, heart, musculoskeletal, dental and gastrointestinal, and blood too. It is a multisystemic disorder. It is manifested as limb girdle muscular weakness. It is affecting the shoulder and the pelvic muscle weakness with respiratory symptoms and progression to respiratory insufficiency ultimately. So prompt diagnosis and establishment of early replacement therapy is associated with maximized clinical benefits. Symptoms of especially late onset Pompe disease, it is very wide and broad and variable. So sometimes isolated with only single symptoms and sign, and sometimes associated with other one or two features. So if you patient can be presented only solely with rigid spine syndrome or scoliosis, low body mass, or asymptomatic hyperkalemia, asymmetric ptosis, tongue weakness, or dysphagia, fatigue, mild hearing loss due to sensory hearing loss, low bone mineral density, scoliosis, osteoporosis. These features sometimes mimicking other disease, and people would think about other disease rather than Pompe disease. All these three cases is a Pompe disease was presented, for example, here with unilateral ptosis, confusing with myasthenia gravis, scapular winging, confusing with facial scapular muscular dystrophies or other limb girdle muscular dystrophies. Here, Gower sign also is part of the Pompe disease. So they confused with like Duchenne or Duchenne-Becker muscular dystrophies or other limb girdle muscular dystrophy too. Pompe disease is one disease, but it's variable onset and progression. And that's because, and the spectrum is differ in the onset, severity, and the progression of the disease. And that's reflected actually by the acid alpha-glycosidase enzyme activity level. If we talk about the infantile onset of Pompe, usually is early onset, below 12 months of life, associated with cardiomyopathy, and rapid progression and fatal by the 1 year. And the level of the enzyme usually is undetectable or even below 1%. Whereas the late onset Pompe disease, symptom appear in infancy or adulthood usually above 12 months and progress associated with progressive muscle weakness, cardiomyopathy in this age group usually less likely, but more variable disease course and also variable phenotype. And that is due to either low or moderate GA activity, usually above 1 to 40%. Early respiratory insufficiency can be a predominant clinical feature of Pompe disease, and it is the key feature of late onset Pompe disease and should alert all neurologists or physicians to this presentation. So it, in a retrospective analysis of patient of hereditary myopathy, early respiratory insufficiency as a predominant clinical features. From 22 patients, 6 patients where they found have respiratory problems. So around 27%. And these symptoms at onset initially either dyspnea or orthopnea or non-restoring sleep or hypersomnolence on the daytime. All patients had restrictive pattern or reduced maximal respiratory pressures on pulmonary function test. How we can recognize and diagnose patient with Pompe disease? So as we said, late onset Pompe disease is a progressive disabled, high mortality rate. That's why required early recognition for early treatment. Recognition with a definitive diagnosis of Pompe disease is critical. And Pompe disease is rare. And late onset disease is difficult to differentiate from other neuromuscular disorder on clinical basis alone. There is low index suspicion of the disease and overlooked or misdiagnosed. Next generation sequencing now can help confirm a diagnosis and rule out other diagnoses. In order to suspect patient with late onset Pompe disease, if the patient have limb girdle type of muscle weakness, you have to think about Pompe disease, mild scapular winging, or muscle weakness, especially the paraspinal muscle weakness, or orthopenia, dyspnea, or morning headaches, which indicate early respiratory insufficiency. The differential diagnosis of Pompe disease or many disease mistaken for Pompe disease mistaken for another disease. So, or maybe diagnosed with other disease rather than Pompe disease. Especially, for example, if we think about infant onset of Pompe disease, the people confuse it with spinomuscular atrophy, congenital hypothyroidism, congenital muscular dystrophy, glycogen storage disease, carnitine, paroxysmal disorder, or myocarditis, or mitochondrial, or other congenital cardiomyopathy disease. The late onset, the most common mimic or mistaken for Pompe disease is like limb girdle muscular dystrophy, Duchenne-Becker muscular dystrophy, inflammatory myopathy, or other metabolic myopathy, glycogen storage disease, myasthenia gravis, polymyositis, or other inflammatory myopathy. So the clue here for Pompe disease from these more common mimic of myopathies, if the patient presented with a respiratory insufficiency, so Pompe disease is most likely, as polymyositis, inflammatory myopathy, and limb girdle muscular dystrophy, as you see here, less likely to present with a respiratory insufficiency. So focus on respiratory insufficiency if you are getting confused with either one of the three, limb girdle, inflammatory myopathy, or polymyositis. And the other hand side too, if the patient, for example, have symptoms mimicking myasthenia gravis or other myopathy, metabolic myopathy, for example, or especially the metabolic myopathies, usually these such cases, they have normal CK, whereas Pompe disease have elevated CK. However, I need to emphasize also, absence of respiratory insufficiency or normal CK does not rule out also Pompe disease. We have to keep our differential open for Pompe disease. Unfortunately, because of the heterogeneity and the wide variable symptoms of late onset Pompe disease, there is a delay on diagnosing Pompe disease. For example, the onset and symptom, if it is less than 12 months without evidence of cardiomyopathy, or onset more than 12 months and less than 12 years, in a number of 118 patients, the delay almost 12 years. Also, if the onset and symptoms above 12 years, from 426 patients, there is a significant delay also around 8 years between from the onset of the disease until the diagnosis. So that's really the awareness of this disease is important in order to detect cases as early as possible. What challenge we are facing as neurologists or as a physician to diagnose patients with Pompe disease? Because as we said, phenotypic, penetrance variability, common sign and symptoms with other disease, difficulty of biochemical diagnostic, lack of awareness lead to missed cases, delayed diagnosis, and delayed treatment. So we focus on multiple tools are typically used in diagnosing late onset Pompe disease. For example, if you have like musculoskeletal problems, EMG and nerve conduction is important to detect any abnormality or can lead you to Pompe disease. Pulmonary function test in patient with early respiratory insufficiency, and also the diagnostic test can be used like GA enzyme activities, like dry blood spot test, and also genetic testing for like next generation sequencing. Additional tests can help you also the level of CK, liver enzymes, LDH, urinary hexose, tetrosaccharide, which indicate the glycogen accumulation. Also muscle biopsy histopathology can also indicate vacuoles, which indicate also more of Pompe disease. Finally, on the diagnosis of this disease, the algorithms in order to help diagnose this patient, if you have patient with proximal limb girdle-like or obstructive respiratory insufficiency or asymptomatic hypercytemia, do nerve conduction study for this test. And if it is normal, so dry blood spot. And if it is positive, retest it. And if it is positive, go for genetic analysis or genetic or GA tissue assay or histopathology assay. If then the EMG or the nerve conduction study is abnormal, so suspect other neuromuscular disorders and do also DBS. If it is negative, it is think about other neuromuscular disorders. How the outcome and the natural history of late onset Pompe disease? This disease actually is a progressive disease with higher mortality. So many late onset Pompe's disease symptoms overlap with other neuromuscular disorders. Differential diagnosis is difficult and is commonly misdiagnosed. Testing is critical for timely diagnosis. Next generation sequencing enables simultaneous screening for several diseases with overlapping phenotypes and can progress to loss of mobility, reduced respiratory function, and impaired daily activities. So late onset reduced mobility, so around 50 to 70% of patients will be a wheelchair bound or wheelchair user by 10 to 15 years. And the annual increase of using wheelchair is around 13%. Also, on the other side, reduces respiratory function, around 40 to 60% of our patient of Pompe disease will be ventilatory user by 10 to 15 years of the disease. And the annual increase of having ventilatory user by 80% each year. Prospective natural history study of motor and respiratory decrease in late onset disease. It is the first prospective study to describe clinical feature of Pompe disease in children and adults. The objective to identify appropriate outcome measures for their use in clinical trials. It is designed a 12-month prospective cohort study, multi-center, multinational observational study, enrollment of 58 patients between 24 to 69 years with a median of 52.6, all patient ambulatory, free of ventilatory support. The measurement or the endpoint use is quantitative muscle testing, functional activity assessment, 6-minute walking test, and pulmonary function test. They exclude any patient would require the use of ventilatory support or having received any investigational drug within the 30 days of the study. Finally, the results showed significant decline in muscles and respiratory, skeletal muscle and respiratory muscle strength and pulmonary function over the 12 months. And that's the 6-minute walking test was not assessed statistically as the study lacked the baseline assessment. Whereas the forced volume capacity shows significant decline by 12 months. Also quantitative muscle testing shows significant decline by 12 months. And the predicted also pulmonary function test, especially the mean expiratory pressure, saw significant decline by 12 months. So this disease is really is progressing to disability and increased mortality as soon as possible. So that really pushed us to the early replacement therapy in order to prevent progression of this disease. So we emphasize, even if you have solely or single symptoms from the down list, think about Pompe disease. So if the patient have scoliosis, even if you don't have weakness, test for Pompe test, skull, winging scapula, abdominal muscle weakness, and difficulty in standing from up chair or climbing stairs, so which indicate limb girdle type of weakness, morning headache. Morning headache is a vague symptoms. So you have to add it with muscle weakness. If it is associated with muscle weakness and morning headache, that also indicate early respiratory insufficiency. Macroglossia, which is associated with difficulty chewing or swallowing. So you need to think about Pompe disease in such case. Difficulty in switching from supine position to sitting position, waddling gait, persisting fatigue, which is indicate exercise intolerance, sleep apnea, which is also indicate respiratory insufficiency. So in such cases, think about Pompe disease and test for this late onset disease, which is really, the test is very simple. Now, thanks for Sanofi Genzymes for using this project, and it is available in the whole GCC countries and many worldwide countries too. It is very simple. It is rapid, simple testing using dried blood spot for GA enzyme activities, minimally invasive and convenient sample collection paper, as you see here on the right side, enough to send through regular mail, reliable to screen large number of patients, provide a faster result than the usual fibroblast cultures or genotyping. So that's a screening test. If the enzyme level is low, you will go later on for the genetic testing. If the enzyme is normal and the phenotype going with other disease, so it will really shorten your algorithm in the diagnosis of Pompe disease. Finally, we conclude that the prevalence of late onset Pompe disease is much higher than predicted and are underdiagnosed. Late onset Pompe disease is slowly progressive, form associated with residual enzyme activity. Early clinical manifestation of late onset Pompe disease include progressive muscle weakness and or respiratory failure. The differential diagnosis of Pompe disease include many disorder, which may be difficult to distinguish on a clinical basis alone. Next generation sequencing has the capability to test concurrently for all these muscle disorder. So the next generation sequencing project also provided by Sanofi Genzyme, which is really motivate genetic testing for limb girdle as well as Pompe disease. They test for the 9 common muscular limb girdle muscular dystrophy, create awareness about Pompe disease and overlapping phenotype with limb girdle muscular dystrophies, as you see below here. The method and panel was designed as a genetic diagnostic tools for neuromuscular and neurological specialists. Evaluate a profile of variant of 9 most common recessive, worldwide most common recessive limb girdle muscular dystrophies with the GAA gene for Pompe. Genetics available from NGS kits, paper card-like. Finally, we thanks our audience and would like to thanks Sanofi Genzymes for their invitation. And would like also to thank the organizing committee for Eminence Conference. Thank you.